Okay, seems like we are on, if I'm not mistaken. So we wanted to do this live, but unfortunately we couldn't. So we're going to download, or I'm going to do this and record this by myself in my office all alone, and then share this with Implant Compare Blake, and he's going to give you guys the link, emails and everything, so that way you guys can actually access this. So oops, let me close that door and then bring this down. Get rid of my thing and then get on my Keynote and get started. So here we are. Let me make sure that I am there as well. One there. Perfect. So cool. I'm gonna close that. Let's start with tips and tricks of dental photography. Play. Awesome. So, my name is Dr. Paymon Racy. I go by Dr. Payray. The reason I did this dental photography PowerPoint, I was asked to do a speaking at Voices of Dentistry last month, and this was a few months ago, where I thought of what am I going to do? Other than talk about something I love, and that is really photography. I like to teach implants, I like to teach other stuff like case acceptance and everything else, but I am very passionate about photography. So I started making this PowerPoint, but the thing is that it was so much for that 20, 30 minute talk that I couldn't really give the whole thing. And I told the folks over there that, hey, why don't we just do this in a more full depth, more in details after the show, after the conference. So that's pretty much where we are right now. I made this tonight to record it live because that would make it easier a little bit because it would be more conversational. But unfortunately, you couldn't get it that route to work. So what I'm going to do is to record this and then share it with you guys tomorrow or later. So let's go. By the end of the time that you watch this, by the end of this PowerPoint that I'm gonna give tonight, you guys are gonna be able to do all of this yourself at your offices, and that's the whole goal for me to be able to make you understand all of those pictures, how it's taken. So how we're gonna do this is I'm gonna speak or start talking about the need for. Actually, hold on one second. Let me post this on Instagram because I'm telling people, everybody's messaging like, what's going on? Let me make sure that they know. Sorry, live didn't work. Cool. Okay, so we're going to talk about the need. Why is it so important to take pictures? Why is photography so important for the practice, for your practice, for everybody's And pretty much right now, these days, everywhere you look, every dentist have their website and they have photos and they got so much stuff that they're getting so much more case acceptance and so much more stuff. So we're going to get into the need, how important it is, then the why. Like, why are you really wanting to get into photography? Like, what's your main reason? What are you trying to do? Then we're going to talk about cameras, like different bodies. We're going to talk about lenses, what type of macro lens you want to get, or other types of lenses that are out there. Flashes, we're going to talk about that. I'm going to be talking about also aperture, shutter speed, exposure. We're going to talk about some of the mode dial, white balance, and move on to consents, where we're going to talk about you need to have what type of consents for these folks that when you're taking pictures of. Also accessories, like some of these stuff, really photos that you take, you really need to have certain stuff. For it to work, you really need to have good camera, good setup, and good equipment. So I'm going to talk about those. We're going to show you some case examples of intraoral photography, then some extraoral photography. I'm going to share with you some of my posturing, positioning, how I'm going to position patients. So I have my, actually, I did that last minute with my assistant a couple hours ago. So we're going to share that with you. Also, I'm going to have some homework for you guys to do at home. I mean, not home really, but like in your office, where you can take pictures of your staff and start doing this and having it a part of your protocol for every new patient. But after that, we're going to talk about some of the post-production. I know some folks asked a lot of questions about post-production. What do you do after? So we're going to talk about that. Then the apps, some of the apps I use, some of the software that I use on my computer, on my Mac, and so forth, like on my iPad, on my iPhone. Pretty much everywhere I'm at, I need to have access to my Dropbox. I'll share some of that info with you guys as far as where do I save these things. At the end, I'm going to talk a little bit about learning resources, some of the places you can learn this stuff for free. Some of them you have to pay. But what are we going to talk about? So let's get started with the need. So here's where I'm going to talk about, like, really, you already, if you're listening to this and watching this, you probably know the importance of photography. So I don't really need to make this a big deal. However, if you're not taking photos right now in your office, you're so behind, and you're getting behind more and more, no matter how old you are, how old is your office, and all sorts of things. So I'm gonna get into what you need to get it started. Some of the things I do in my practice is taking pictures of every single patient, pretty much that I work on, surgery or other things. Now, I show these are some of the reason for me doing so many cases. If you guys follow me on either social media or Facebook and Instagram, you see how much cases that I do. It's really depending on how much photography I've taken. If it wasn't really for photography, I wouldn't even been asked to do so many speaking different places, because a lot of folks have seen it. And it is just so important and powerful message that you send out, because a lot of people that I have done thousands and thousands of dollars of cases, they were already sold before they saw me. So it is, there's no question about how important it is to have a good setup, have a great camera and all that stuff. So this is the need from all the 20 tips that I'm going to give you. After the need is really what I want to say is, what is your why? What is it that you really want to do? For example, if are you thinking about educating and teaching, then you need to focus on taking some of these nice photos for definitely accreditation and also education. If some people want to do, and I do it in a way, I started doing it out of a school. Just a little background about how I started, or how did I get into it, was really getting out of school. I had no idea about cameras. I know in school some people borrowed cameras, and I was like, man, I don't need that. I got my iPhone. And then ended up really getting out of school, and I realized it did a ton of before after pictures of, or we did a lot of denture. It was a denture practice that I started, and a lot of people know I started working at a denture practice, and then the life-changing experience that some of these folks were going under was amazing. And that was where it kind of got my eye, and caught my attention into like, man, I need to take pictures of these folks. So that's how I started. I was like, man, I need to do this before and after. So that's how I did. Now I'm about 40,000 photos of folks on my Dropbox. I've got so many cases, and I've got different reasons, my reasons that I do that. So what is your why? Is it for communication? Is it research? And is it for showing patients, case acceptance? For me, it works in every different things I do. Like as far as teaching, it works. If I do show patients, it works. Now, main focus of this really presentation is more about, less about research and those type of things. Now, of course, I'm gonna talk a little bit about macro photography too, but mostly this is really for clinical photography in your practice, like every day to day type of things. Now, I'm sure there's gonna be cool little nuggets and tricks that you guys could use and take advantage of. While I'll go through all of that. So find your why. Next, we're going to talk about the camera, the body. Now, what are some of the cameras out there? Really right now, you know, Canon and Nikon are probably the top two. Canon being a little bit older than Nikon. Nikon being older than Canon. However, Canon is like a lot bigger than Nikon as far as the whole manufacturer, the company goes. So it is really comparing apples and oranges. So like Canon works with a lot of people, Nikon works with a lot of other folks. So I'm not here to tell you you need Canon or Nikon. I'm sharing with you, I do have a Nikon, DA10 is what I have, that's why I have it highlighted. And that is my camera. It is a full frame camera and I love it. It's the best thing ever. I spent a little bit more money on it. However, it is a great camera. Now, if you have a Canon, if you already have these cameras, then that's fine. If you're thinking about getting a camera, I have some articles here for you guys to read. You could get on the best DSLR cameras in 2019. You could look at the list. They have a lot of lists, 10 of the top 10. And those actually that you're seeing on the screen are most of them. Then for some folks that already have mirrorless cameras, there are several differences that I'm not going to get into the technical, but that's why you could kind of get on that article also and read the differences. So I do not really recommend a mirrorless camera. I think for photography, especially dental photography, you really need a DSLR camera. Every single sport organization or talk about anything professional industries, they all use DSLR cameras. So why not dentistry be one of them? I think there are so many folks that think that, oh, I'm gonna save money doing mirrorless and it's better, it's lighter. Really, you need a DSLR camera. Now, when it comes to the full frame versus crop sensor, the full frame and crop sensor are pretty much the same thing, except full frame, it makes it easier. For example, if you took a picture from here, if I took a picture of my Mac, I can get more in my frame because it's full frame than a crop sensor, because crop sensor is going to multiply by a certain number of magnification to make it smaller. So what you need to do is to kind of sit, come back or go move forward in order to see that. So crop sensor, there's nothing wrong with it, but full frame is always cool because it's more. It's kind of like if you really want to think about comparing them, if you have, if it's raining and you go out and start putting buckets and small bucket outside to start collecting rain, and your neighbor goes and starts collecting rain, except they're going to put bigger buckets. After an hour, their buckets are going to be more water because they have bigger. So full frame is just that. It is no, I mean, everybody takes, I mean, you can still take pictures with the regular crop sensor, but it's not as big. So you kind of have to adjust your positioning and where you are compared to your subject. And then Nikon versus Canon comparison, you could go through that list. I'm really gonna get into it. But if you have your camera, that's good, and have it with you probably throughout this presentation, because there's gonna be a few things that I'm gonna mention that you wanna look at your camera to see. Where are they? Lens. For macro lens is pretty much what I prefer, and I think you, for dental photography, you really need a macro lens. That's a one-to-one life size images. What I have is this one for Nikkor. It's micro or a macro lens. When it says micro, that's really macro lens. So it's more of It gets very, very detailed, and that's the best lens that I could find. I do have a few other lenses that are not 105, and I'm not happy with the photos. Like when they come out, they're not as crisp and good looking as that lens. So I 100% recommend the prime telephoto macro lens. That would be a great one for photography. After lens, we're going to talk about flash. So flash is very important. I'm not a big fan of ring light. However, there are some out there that come with two different type of flash that you could mount it on the ring. So that way you could kind of adjust the light how it goes. Now, ring light also not bad for really surgical pictures. So if you're a surgeon, if you do a lot of surgeries, and you want to really get close to it, your subject or your zone of the posterior mandible or maxilla, wherever you are, you do want to get close, and a ring light is okay. I have that bracket on my camera. I used to carry that all the time, but now I'm getting, I got so tired of it because it's so heavy, I stopped doing it. Now that I have my own office, I do have a room set up dedicated for camera and photography. That camera, that picture that you guys see here, I'm not sure if the mouse is going to show. However, this is how my office looked when I first started. Now, I kind of switched the photography setup a little bit, but that is how I did. I got my room set up. Now, with lenses or flash, I'm sorry. This is the one I was suggesting. So there's that R1 C1 wireless macro flash. This is a great one that you could get. Now also there are strobes, and I can talk about the strobes as well as the softbox in a second. I think I'll get into it. Actually, here you go. That's the softbox. So here's my setup. If you look at it, I have one right and one left, and then I have one behind the patient that I take my camera and take the pictures that way. Here's my bracket, and yeah. So then I have the mount, and I'll also share with you guys the other parts and pieces. I give you the links of them so you have it. The settings is pretty boring stuff, but it is very important. You need to know what is your aperture. You need to know what's your shutter speed, and you need to know your ISO. Now, it is very simple, really. A couple of the things you're not really going to change much. There's going to be shutter speed, and there's going to be ISO that you really much, you're going to have it at those settings. I have it written down there as 1/200 of a second, and the other one 1/160 of the second. And that's pretty much where I have my shutter speed set at. And you could have it at the same time, at the same speed. The aperture, however, is the f-stop. That's pretty much the diaphragm of your lens. So how the depth of focus is going to be determined based on the aperture. So what do I set my aperture at? Most of the time, 12 and maybe 14 for my portraits. So I kind of stay back and take the pictures. I'll show some of the postures and positioning later, where I did an example with my assistant a few hours ago. But then for intraoral, I do it a little bit higher. So I do 22 or even 29, 32, sometimes even 36. And that is the depth of focus. And that's how many teeth are gonna be in focus. So you gotta go higher. I have a little triangle here for you guys so you could kind of capture this and see what is this in terms of like how much light you need. So I have this kind of ingrained in my mind that where as soon as I take my picture and I see it, if it's too light, I switch things back and forth. If you really understand this, it's perfect. However, you don't have to. You can set up those numbers that I told you, but if you really want to get into it, you can really learn more about them by just going to Google and exposure setting, and it's not really hard to find stuff about it, but that's a good diagram. Mode dial, or this is this button. I don't know if you see it, but it's this button on top of the Nikon. It comes with different type of priority, like aperture or you want to set it at program like shutter priority or aperture priority. These are where the camera chooses the other stuff for you, and then you choose the aperture. Or the shutter priority, the same thing. It sets, the camera is going to do some stuff, and then you do the other. I have my camera on manual, and I recommend you too. Like, I honestly don't think it is that hard to learn. If you're a dentist and you can do the dentistry, I think it's pretty simple to understand three things. And those numbers are pretty simple to understand. So I think you can really start doing manual. However, at the beginning, if you really want the camera to do some of the work, you could look at that and start choosing what you want them to control. Auto is, I don't really like that, so I like manual. Because auto and shutter priority stuff, sometimes it works, but based on where you are in the room, then sometimes it doesn't. So I like to do manual. Just wanted to share this with some of the folks that may want to use that gig from their camera. Okay, white balance. This is so important because dentists are the coolest people when it comes to white balance. We understand light more than so many other professions, because if you look at the picture in the left and look at the picture on the right, that the white balance is cool on the left and it's pretty warm on the right. So the temperature that I like my white balance to be whenever I take photos are going to be pretty much, I have it listed 5,500 to 6,500. Now range kind of dictated by where you are in your office. The light is everything. If you want to take one thing about this photography session, other than there's so many actually nuggets, no, this is not the only one, but you can get the light is life. So much powerful. So where you are in the office, how lights is set up is going to determine how white, yellow, and all that, you know, white balance thing is going to be. So how you change the white balance on your camera is going to be, for example, for Nikon, there's a WB. And I could just do the info and WB, and I could change it on here and change it to different type of, I don't know if you guys can see, but I have those actually items on those little figures there, so you could see what it means. I don't really mess with it though, because I always have it at the daylight. I usually like to have daylight because that's where patients see their teeth and they want to be in daylight, so I usually use that or flash. Okay, consents are so important. Every single patient that comes in and they have pictures of my cases posted, they need to have a sort of a consent. Now that consent could be different. This one has three different levels of permission. So for example, if the doc, if the patient really wants to just give you, I mean, I take pictures of patients no matter what. However, if some of them don't want this to be shared with anybody else except themselves and to be part of their record, that would be a confidential record only, and nobody else gets to see them. If they want me to share, and they're okay with me sharing their stuff on educational stuff, I have level two, so research and education. And then I have for third one is where I could do it everything, pretty much put it on my website, on my Instagram, social media, and everything. So that's where most of my staff, that's where they talk and ask them where, which level they feel comfortable, and they could do that and sign this. So make sure you have the consent signed before you get in trouble and get sued, because that's not pretty. And I know some doctors that actually have got sued because of this, mostly in California, because everybody likes to sue each other, but that's a whole other story. Other than that, there's actually another consent that is just the normal one. If you want to take a screen of that, I could share this actually with you guys, maybe too, with a page of Microsoft Word with all the links. So that would be cool. The other thing, now moving on from the consent, is going to be the accessories. Some of these things that I use. So soft boxes that I didn't really talk about much is coming up here though. So these are the mounted brackets. Let me turn this down a little bit. That is my flash. I have Nissin i40. This is the mount that I have in my operatory that I take the pictures with in my operatory room where I do surgeries. I can share with you guys the link for this so that way you can get it from Amazon and have somebody install it for you. That's what I did. I had somebody install it, and this is how it looks. Yeah, I can pretty much take it in and out, bring it in and out. And I have some exercises in the, I think it's coming up here shortly, where I'll show how I work with it. Now, after you have that, or you got the strobes that I went over and the flash, the softboxes, I'll give you the link. You definitely need this. I think everybody could afford having a couple of these in their offices. Maybe somewhere you really need 3, 4, 5 feet. You don't really need a whole room. I have a whole room just because I didn't really have patience to put in there, so I put my photography stuff in there. But later on, I probably want to make sure that I use that room as actually a room for patients and producing money, because anywhere I can take those pictures with having those strobes. Now, moving to the mirrors, let's look at that. And retractors, because these are so important. Let's see. Okay, cheek retractors. I like these T-shaped. I think I said that also over at the Voices. I'm not a big fan of those. However, I do like these metal ones. I'll show you how these look also in my setup. If you want to get the implant retractor, I get a lot of questions asked about those. So if you like those, get them from Salvin. That's where I order them. I can share that as well with you guys. I have all of this later. For mirrors, I like these mirrors from the website. They are a little bit more expensive. And unfortunately, yes, they do get scratched. And that's because you're going to autoclave and you're going to use them. So you may want to get cheaper ones too. I have cheaper ones and then I have the other ones. But I love the other ones just because they have the handle. So it makes it super easy for my staff and team to take occlusal pictures. These are the bendable contraster. I love those bendable ones. And I'll show you later how those, I can kind of make them, kind of bend them to where I want them, pretty much. The last but not least, there's Shadowbox for some of the folks that do take pictures. They want to take pictures of their models, jewelry stuff, or whatever the casts or crowns come in. You don't really want to spend $300 on that from PhotoMed, so I have that. However, if you go on Amazon, you can get them $20-$30 a Shadowbox. I do have that as well. I just don't take as many cast pictures that I used to. I used to take a ton of cases coming from the lab, but now I just go straight to the mouth and take those pictures. My black and white background, also on Amazon. Use the disposable ones because they're cheaper. And then you can always change them. Ring light is great for videography. I also have that in my room. Pretty $50, $60 or so. And then that is an excellent advantage. Here is actually my room. You can see that that video or that ring light. The batteries, I love these batteries from Panasonic. I actually have these set up for my the whole office. So everywhere we have batteries, we use these, like mouse, keyboard, and other stuff. So that's actually another cool advantage of those batteries, because they're rechargeable. If you get the memory cards, I love the ones that are speeder. The speed is a little bit faster. It's 95 megabyte per second. And it's fast transfer, especially if you're going to take some good pictures with your camera. You want to get them transferred. So let's move on from the accessories. Let's do some clinical photography before we start falling asleep. Okay, so these are the photos that we take. Natural smile is just I ask the patient smile and then I'll take a picture. I think I can show you more of these with you guys later when I do the exercise. I'll show you the videos for the exercise. But just to give you some sort of background or some of these pictures that I do take is some that are natural smile. How do I like to take these pictures? Or by having the patient seated and then I'll take it from above, like when I stand up, because I like to see patients like looking up to down, because if I'm seeing, if you notice, if you're looking at people and you're looking at their teeth, you're pretty much, your eyes is going down to their teeth. That has the pretty much angulation of maybe 10 degree 6 degree or whatever, where your eyes kind of looking down at their teeth. So when you're posting pictures online, if you really think about it, if you make that also that illusion of when patient or when people look at your photo and it's a little bit slightly from the top, it makes it a little bit actually better than normal, like looking at them from flat, from straight ahead. Now it's cool to do it straight ahead. However, if you just move that just a hair notch, very, very little, it makes your photos a little bit more person that sees it. It has a more, this is actually a person. Like it just makes that illusion that they're also looking at a live person down. So that's a little thing that you could do. With a retracted photos, I have the ones that we do take. Some of them are the metal ones and then the retractors that I've shown. So these are some of the pictures that I've taken. Now here's actually an example of the ones I don't like. And this is why I don't like, because they, not only the color of them, but also they're not as pretty and getting them wide, their cheeks out of the way, as the other ones that are clear or the metal ones. And I'll show you those too. Here's some of the upper anterior teeth with a contraster. So here you could see I have the contraster behind. It's funny because on the top photo, I didn't have the contraster. I just created that contrast. It's not really perfect because I didn't really put much time to it. But in Photoshop or Lightroom, I don't think you could do it. It's Lightroom. But in Photoshop, you could really put a nice contraster for any of your photos. But it's so much easier if you have it. So if I don't have the photo or the contraster, I can always contrast it, but I always try to get my staff to bring me contraster for every patient. Here's another one that this was actually the patient that we did put contraster. So you could see the difference is much more clear. These are some of the ones retracted again with the contraster on top and without it. You could see if I did the contraster on the bottom, this image and the incisor edge would actually look even better than not having the contraster, because you can see the top, see the incisal edge, and then here it does have it, but it is not showing because there's no contraster. Now lateral views are awesome because you could see from the side how they look. Now here's the actually lateral view. You definitely want to kind of pull this cheek, but you don't have to pull that much as much, and the other side as much. Here's the after one of the same patient that we did a full mouth on. Here's another one that, again, you want to be able to see the back teeth. Now, in this case, we couldn't really open a stretcher in the way back. So what you could do, also put buckle mirrors. I don't really like buckle mirrors. I like to do this instead of buckle mirrors. But if you definitely want to capture some of the facials on those posterior molars, you definitely need to get a buckle mirror. And then I have them too, so it's just that I don't use them as much. You could definitely use them. Close-ups are for fun. I take these every now and then when I get bored with some of the regular photos. Now, what they are is pretty much very, very, very close with the same lens, same setup, and you could take those photos. I have a few of these that you could kind of see nice stippling and beautiful, beautiful architecture of the teeth. Here's another one that we took the healing color off and I was like, wow, that looks so gorgeous. So I just took that picture. Here's another one with the bone being exposed. Here's a cool little tori for you if you want to take that out. Good luck. Okay, now some of the extra oral, I feel like I've already shown this. I have definitely shown them, but this is, again, these are the ones that cases that sell. I have so many of these, and I even have more that I haven't published, but you need to take portraits. And portraits, I'll get to the examples here in a second. I think it's actually right after this. Lab communication, I really need more time to talk about this. So what I did, instead of talking about the lab communication, how to cross polarization, how to show the color, shade, and stuff, I really wanted to focus on the clinical photography and make you be able to do this really at your office after you watch this. So I'm going to focus more on that instead of lab communication. So what I'm going to really be doing is going to be, before I get into the post-production, I'm going to show you the example. So I'm going to come out of this. Let me go back on, make sure that I'm running. Cool, we got 34 minutes going. Awesome, let me get this back. Now let's get on this videos. So here is the first video. So this is my room. I'm gonna kind of shut this down so you can kind of hear me as I'm going through this. I have, let me put it, maybe hopefully you guys could see. Okay, cool. I think you guys can see it. All right, so the let's move forward. So here's my mount, a mounted bracket. This is the one I don't really use anymore as much because it is super heavy in the room. So what I do instead of using that, and as you can see, this is pretty flexible. So you could kind of move it around and adjust the angulation and sides because it's kind of ball head. So you could do all that angulation stuff. Make it adjusted, but the problem with them, they're just heavy. So the next one, the video that I will show is going to be bringing the patient back. How am I gonna position them? This is Summer. She was kind enough to let me do this last minute on her before closing the office. But I bring the mounted and the strobe light on top of the patient. I actually bring them down just a little bit. But here's the setup, as you could see. Some of these that I have now, I'm not a big fan of this contraster that my assistant brought, so I'll have her change that in a second. But I like the ones that are bendable. That one is not. So what I do, let's get this is actually a little thing that you could do.
As you see, this is the end, so this
We
goes
have
for the
this kind
maxillary,
of up.
and
No,
finally
you can hear that.
this way that will go for mandibular. So whatever point direction this is has going now. So this is good for the maxilla. So the way I place it, so I have one of their go one side, and at the other side, instead of me using my finger to get it in, I'll use a mirror and easily get it in. More like that. You got a small mouth, so it's a little tricky. Now, you always have patients that have a small mouth, but normally this thing works for everybody except very few people.
Very few
So once we have
people.
that
Very few
set,
people. I haven't been able to put that thing in, but everybody really, I can get them in. Now, the
so
only ones that I can't really get in
now
are the edentulous
super
patients that have
fast.
nothing to in a long time.
There's usually my
Let's
assistant
see, where are we going?
outside
After
the
this, what
contrast
I will
room,
show is going to
which
be,
I
okay, so here's the bendable
I
contrastor
want to
that I
find
had
the best patients to help me with either one of these.
my assistant to
Sometimes I have them
bring.
hold the contrast, sometimes I have them hold the beam.
And sometimes you could ask the patient to hold them for you. Don't
Now,
hesitate, especially
sometimes
if the
it
patient is
says,
younger and they're cool to do it, then
hurry up,
let them
hurry
do
up.
it instead of having your
Don't
assistant.
talk to me.
But have the
Don't
assistant to
talk
do
to me.
something else. And again, I'm kind of zooming in and out, looking at my.
So you can see what it looks like now. The light is good. I have this at 25.
So here you can see, I have it at F25. The shutter speed is 1/200, just like I said. And as you saw the image, it's not bad.
I have
However,
1/200 second shutter speed. So my aperture is F25 and 200. And then I'm setting it at manual. Then
but I wanted to get a little bit more
a little bit of
depth.
tissue. You want to come close so they need to see what I'm holding here.
So she's
My
holding that
hand
in the
is really
back.
kind of pushing up or pulling up. And then she's going to hold it for me as I go in.
And then I always need
Sometimes
to be in the
you can
middle.
hold the
Like, I
middle
really
up
need to be in the
here.
middle of number 8 and 9.
You get the saliva off of the interproximal fits
And
in
that's
there.
a cool trick too. Always get the saliva off and the interproximal flossed. You don't want to see food in between the teeth. That's so gross. So let's look at that. If we could show that too, I'm not sure.
So
Okay, so you could see how it looks. It looks better. You can see the gum and everything. So these are the photos that you could capture
here we
tomorrow.
go
You
again.
should be doing the same thing.
Now, if I wanted to change this, if I didn't, if I wanted to get more light, I would turn it to f22. However, I'm going to lose the depth of focus. So I'm going to actually move it up even higher to f32 because I want to get some of the back teeth.
So as you saw, what I said was f32. So I'm moving up my aperture. Therefore, my light is going to get darker.
And more towards themselves and instead of the middle. So the pictures turn out to be a lot not aligned. So as you see, you want to make it where it's in the middle right there.
Cool.
Okay. Now you can come in and look at this. Now, because the light is going to get darker, because I changed the F25 to 32. So another way now, I keep that F32. However, what I'm going to do is to turn my ISO on as the light is less. So I'm going to turn the ISO to like 400.
So now I get more light because of it. Awesome. So these are the incisor edges photos that you could take. Let me go forward to see.
I normally like to have these in or that one. Whichever way you want that one.
Now both of those work for occlusal pictures.
Yeah, these two. The way I position them in the mouth is it's got a thing on here, so you could really get. There's another one that I like that doesn't have to do either one. Mm-hmm. Now, you get it in.
I like the T1s because they don't have one end. Only have one end. And it's pretty cool because you could have them put that in and then kind of bring it out.
And then you have the other one. Come in again, slowly get it in from here. Can you help me? So then I ask the patient if they can hold these like that. Like that. I'm gonna go ahead and close. That perfect. Awesome. So now I could get in. These are just the. Good. So you can see that. The f-stop, I'm going to have it on f32. My ISO is 400. I'm going to change the ISO, probably bring it down maybe to ISO to like 200. Good. So slightly open.
I'm going to go in and actually see.
Good. So now it looks a little bit like this. So this is the raw image that we're looking at.
Because
I think I'm going to show this after. The big end, so should we use the small end? Or, and then it's right here, and then we can pull it towards up if you can.
So now that we're doing the occlusal shots, we want to make it where she is going to hold, she's going to hold the mirror for me.
Perfect.
And then see what I'm doing, or I guess here. See what I'm doing wrong and then how I'm fixing it. And that's pretty much, these are some of the hardest shots that you were going to pretty much take in occlusal shots are very hard.
My assistant holds them. Depending on if I have it on manual, if I have it on, like right now, looking at it like this. So one of the things that problem
so
is because
I couldn't get, now here's, this is how, look what I'm saying.
She's closed, you're not gonna be able to see the back teeth. Second molars. So if you really wanted the good ones, you have to. I'm gonna put it on auto. Then I'm gonna have that and open big. Perfect.
Yeah, she's gonna fog because the mirror gets foggy, so there's always air there.
Now if you come and look, you're good.
So there's that second picture that we took. It looks better. So we have the second molars
so
here too.
That's how.
Now the mirrors for the lowers are also good to do, and I think I'm doing one too.
That one for the cheek retracting.
Those two are also. Oh, here you go. Perfect. I didn't even know she brought it, but here you go. This is what I like.
Or this one. You could either use that one for the cheek retracting of the lip.
So that that one is cool, and then this one is good for all the occlusal shots.
Lip on the side, and just those. And then the mirror. That's the one that I'm going to introduce to them.
That is the mirror that I talked earlier about.
The occlusal is pretty hard to do it with this setup, but go ahead and so they know what's going on. At the same time, you always want to have their tongue to go back at their mouth. So you ask
so always tell the patient to... always tell the patient what you're doing before you put these things in their mouth. Make sure. So here's the bottom.
Second molars. You can see the teeth.
She needs to fix that composite. It looks like some shrinkage. Okay, so that is really... Let me see if I have... Oh, okay, so cool. Here is where I'm doing my... Like, taking some of these portrait photos.
So for the headshot photos, what I was saying is...
So the light is so important for you to set it up the way, because it's always you want to be consistent.
I just make these four on the outside. And then I have three of these right here. Where are these? These are the strobes that we had in the room that were mounted. However, we want to make sure that because we have the space, we can always do it.
So as you could see, I have two strobes on the side and one in the back.
So then I'll get my camera and I set my aperture on f12.
So I'm recording this and sharing this with you guys.
You put the intro, then you change the shutter speed. I'm going to put it at 1 over 160 and then bring the f-stop to 12. Say 13. And then kind of balance these out a little. And then I'll use my camera in a not in the landscape but in a horizontal, vertical portrait mode. And then take the first one, let me actually put it on manual first. Good. So now it's so much light, so as you see, so I can easily fix it. How do I do that? I do info. I bring the ISO down to 100 because that's where I like it, or even 64. You could put it. I usually like 100 with the ISO. Then the f stop, move it to 16. Nice. However, the flash, there's too much flash. So, what I'm going to do.
So the picture that I was taken from her was really not that good because there was too much light. So what I do, one of the things is always control your flash, make them light come down. See, the problem, or not the problem, but thing that we got to understand with this is don't memorize what your speed number needs to be. Always think about what's going on and how can you fix it by knowing the... Light, if it's too much light, then reduce the light. How can you reduce the light? There is flash lights that you could reduce on those. You have ISO, so if your ISO is 4000 or 3000, 2000 sometimes, then that is super grainy. It looks super noisy, so you want to reduce that super so much light. Then if F32 goes to F25, that means there's going to be more light because my F-stop got reduced and there's going to be more light coming to the lens. So that's where you need to understand the numbers, not the numbers, I'm sorry, but like the actual meaning of what's going on and how can you fix it. And that is pretty much what I was talking about. And we were able to manage.
Make my things change by those. Like, smile. Good. You could see how it looks. Now the white in the background. Now this is a little bit washed out. So what we're going to do is to... Still make the light a little bit, or flashes a little bit less. So play with the flash. More, take it lower, and then take another one. Smile, perfect. Here we go up. And, good. So now you see, it's getting there. We're getting close. Now, You could, again, change the f-stop, move it higher or lower based on how it looks. The other shots I like to take is always asking patients to look that way, like look on the corner of that wall and smile. Yeah, just your head pretty much. Yeah, like that, and then move that way, smile pretty.
So, okay, so yeah, you could see I take a bunch of pictures from different sides.
Put it in your mouth.
Thank you.
It sounded like if you're not putting it in your mouth.
Okay, cool. So I think now is when I take some of these intraoral.
Now, you always want to enter. It has a longer end.
I love those metal retractors actually more than even the plastic ones.
Capture everything on top and bottom. So I like this end, unless the patient cannot handle. So go ahead and put these right. So if you can put in pretty much just like how she put them in and then move it to the side. Put them in and then move it to the side like she did, and then she's gonna hold it. Go ahead and bite down. Now, what I always like to ask them to do is to bring this out more towards me a little bit. Yeah, just like that. Perfect. And then I'll come outside and take my first picture, moving my shutter speed to 27, 25, taking 1, 2, 3.
I meant aperture.
So you could see this right here. It's pretty nice because the lighting is perfect. However, what you're missing or what I'm missing on this is all the posterior teeth. And why is that? Why am I missing all these black corridors? Because the way that I angle these are she's blocking it. What I need to do is to bring this more.
So always bring the flash. So I wanted to show you guys what I missed. Again, how do I fix it? So move your flash. I should have really put the flash. You always want to have a kind of balance of it. You see how one of them is down? I should have probably put it up, make it more symmetrical.
Of course, this would be nicer if it was
down. Now, as you can see, what is going to happen, the photos are going to be now with the light setting up that way.
Okay.
Sometimes I feel like if you're not in behind one of these, the flash might not go off the transmission if it's in front of it. I don't know if it's true or maybe my setup was wrong, but sometimes that is the case. So if you're feeling like it's not triggering, the flash doesn't come off and you're pushing it, then come stay back a little bit. And I think that's what I did to make it work and to flash. But as you can see now, you could start seeing some of these posterior teeth. Now she does have a good curve, so it is harder. You can see she's got some sort of a pretty protruded maxilla, so it is difficult to get the back angle because of that canine eminence. It's kind of going back abruptly now. With those, you don't really have to go crazy and try to get it all in there, but I just wanted to kind of show how this is done. I think it got even better after this one.
Okay, perfect. Now look at this. It's so much better.
Okay, so you can see how I fixed the problem. Now, let's go
perfect.
Forward.
That's pretty much what I wanted. Now, if I wanted to do the lateral, go ahead and make it one more time. Go ahead and put that in.
The lateral ones is
trick to stick down into the lower earth. So go into the lower earth and dry around. That's
dry around, go around. Yes.
Okay,
perfect. Now, I'll come in. So what I always ask them to kind of look
for the lateral shots, you want to have their head posture change a little bit.
This hand, and then take it to the back. So this is where this one goes back instead of front. So I'm pushing that back right there. Hold that.
That's how I was able to show some of those photos to you guys based on that. Now let me, I'm almost done with these videos. Let me see if I have anything else, but let's see. So here's, you can see how what I captured with those lateral shots. You want to see, be able to see some of these embrasures.
she
you're
doesn't.
Really
gonna well, no, you need to based on because that will cover up the other side.
So yeah, you definitely need to have both of them in, but one of them or the other side that you're not worried about doesn't have to be pulled. You just pull out one side.
You see the darker area? That's because this one covered it.
So yeah, you just have to play with your light and make sure it's good. So this is what I wanted you guys to do, really. If you can sit up and train your staff and your team, get with your team, maybe one or two assistants, and do just those practices that I did. Just go back to this, replay it, and have you guys do the same thing. And then look at see what you're doing right and what you're doing wrong. And honestly, if you empower your team and let your team to do this with you, it is going to help you so much more. I have my team to also take photos for me, especially sometimes when I'm so busy doing other things, they take the photos for me. Everything is set up. You can train them, but just have them watch this and start training and practicing with them. So that is pretty much for the practices. Let's go back to the PowerPoint. Let's see. Play. So I use Lightroom for organization, categorizing, and then putting them into different sort of folders. I don't really do it as much as I used to do use the Lightroom. So what I do now is just the Photoshop with editing the, whenever I get the images that come out of my phone, it's been a long day, my camera, what I do is I take, they come in RAW. You always want to be able to record in RAW and make sure you also record in JPEG with a high fine, like the best quality. Always, I have two copies, one RGB or JPEG. I'm sorry, one JPEG that is very fine. And then you also want to record your camera with Canon and Nikon both to be RAW because that is your copyright. That's everything about you. So you can always, especially if you're going to take some of these accreditation, you want to show them the raw images. There's not much really editing. If you do these photos that what I took, the editing and things that I do, those are just for fun. I love playing with colors. And some of these, for example, I have pictures of like, for example, that one that you see, I just love to play with them. So I just made the back background, a black background, and then started looking at these. I think I used not even Photoshop for this. I used one of the apps, Color Splash. I think I'll have it up later. There's not much you need to do. But yeah, if you take these photos raw, you don't really have to do much with them. So this is my workflow: Lightroom, Photoshop, and then Dropbox. Some of my apps that I use, as well as you could see. So for example, Photo Collage. If I want to do some Instagram stuff, I use Moldiv. This is my favorite one. You could kind of do all kinds of collages, put text on them, do stuff. Now with PS Express is, again, quick rendering, raw to JPEG. And that's an app. If you really, really want to get into it, make sure you do it right, I would say open an Adobe account or have, if you have a student, because how I have it, my sister is a resident, so she gave me her student email, so I was able to get it like super, super cheap, monthly or yearly fee, but it is really not much, even if you did it out of pocket, because I used to do it pay $10, and that's pretty much it. It's about $120 a year, and you can use Photoshop and do everything you can. So that's pretty much my workflow. But you have all these apps also that are free. Some of them, as you can see. So for my Instagram, these are like nothing to do with photography. It's just like Cut Story I use for my Instagram. I use YouDoodle. I don't really use it as much. It's just that for if you want to put layers and layers and layers, you could do that. But I do it on Photoshop now. Color Splash is the one that you have the black background. It's that one. Implant Compare is the one you're probably watching this. You want to get that. Instagram Word Swag is cool because you can put some text, and then that one is Cinematography or something. I don't really need that. I don't use that. Okay, so storage, as I said, I get on Dropbox. I save everything on Dropbox. I think I have a business account and I pay like 2-3 terabytes that's there, or even more, I don't know. but it is worth it. Dropbox is my way of communicating with the world, especially with my lab. There's a whole another section on lab, like how do I tell them everything that they would be able to deliver all my cases on point. But that's another day probably. But okay, for learning, now that you're so excited that you can't wait to start doing this, there are a couple sources. These are both my friends, my great friends, Miguel Ortiz in Boston and Eduardo, who doesn't have a house, he travels, but he is actually going to have a thing here soon, March 8, 9. I thought that's cool. So if you want to contact any of them too, if you mention my name, they're probably going to hook you up. They both said the same thing. They will hook you up and give you a discount for their courses. So just mention my name and say that you watched this or you saw me talking about their courses. So those are the two courses that I have personally attended. Both of those folks have been in Nashville. We had them, I had Miguel come in 1 year, and then we had me and Dr. Tremley, Jeff Tremley. He brought Eduardo in. So they're both amazing, and that's pretty much, I would say, if they're coming near you, you might want to definitely hit them up because their courses is inexpensive and it's worth it. Couple of free sources I have. These are FutureLearn. This is Udemy. You could really, Udemy is, I think it's about $10 or something. It's pretty cheap, but you learn so much. If you want to really get into it more on the sitting home, those are some of those sources that you can pay to learn. Spears Education and Dental Photo Master and the Ed McLaren's case. I had that too. And that's somewhere you could also visit. And that is pretty much it. I feel like I've gone through this fast. Here's my number. And also, if you want to get in touch with me and let me know if you have any questions or anything, I try to get back with you as soon as possible. Some of these messages I get, unfortunately, it gets me a few days to reply some because of some of the things I do. But I would definitely try to get back as much as I can. So thank you so much. I apologize. We didn't really do this live, but I hope that you gained something out of this. Please let me know if you watched it, if you want to get any information. I try to get this to Blake to put it on demand for you guys. Thank you. Talk to you guys soon. Bye. So let's get out of this. 1 hour. Perfect.